Hello and welcome to today's session of book reading of Preparing for the Day After. Preparing for the Day After is a picture ebook written and published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian Tsunami. It is a treatise on disaster mitigation. Today I will be reading chapter 2 on the Asian Tsunami in the picture ebook Preparing for the Day After. This is episode 4 of the series. So let us start. Today's reading deals with the history of tsunamis in South and Southeast Asia. This chapter on tsunamis is exhaustive again. In the previous session on 16th of January, we covered in great detail the geological cause and consequence of the Asian tsunami. Today, we will be covering the history of tsunamis in South and Southeast Asia. But let us first recap what we have learned so far. Critical significance of early warning mechanisms cannot be underestimated. Publicity of administrative factors in implementing standard operating procedures is critical. Standard operating procedures need to be robustly publicized. Media has to actively participate in awareness creation. Nuclear power stations should not be located in calamity-prone areas. Transparent governance augments disaster preparedness. No matter how high-profile the scientific infrastructure for early warning, its execution by the executive, that is the bureaucracy, and scrutiny by the fourth estate, the media, is absolutely critical. Information dissemination depends on mass media. So, a well-trained mass media can do a good job of disseminating early warning and information dissemination. While construction of multi-purpose shelters is of utmost importance, other indicators of human development index are important in creating resilience. These indicators include access to health care, water and sanitation, food security, water security, livelihood security, fire brigade stations on a per capita basis, transparent corruption-free government, infrastructure for evacuation, scientific installations for early warning, healthcare infrastructure on a per capita basis. Trained search and rescue teams have to be attached to every village administrative unit, at least in India, and similarly in other countries. Disaster prepared trained paramedical staff on a per capita basis have to be in place for every 150 people. May I suggest that you keep open Google Earth as it serves as a ready reference to the book reading today. The links used for reference in this chapter are put in the description box below the video on our YouTube channel. I highly recommend that you watch the YouTube video of some documentaries listed in the description box. So now let us go on to the real subject, history of tsunamis in South Asia and Indian Ocean region. Dr. Satish Shenoy, former director of the Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services in Hyderabad, shares his deep insight into the tsunamis in the Indian Ocean and South Asia region with readers here. He has sourced material from Columbia University study online, the link of which is listed in the description box below, but then it might not have public access very easily. Thus, it helps for you if I can read it out. The earthquake of June 26, 1941 is among the strongest earthquakes ever recorded in the Andaman Nicobar Islands with a magnitude of 7.7. The earthquake occurred at 12.5 degrees north, 92.57 degrees east, which is about 96.7 kilometers north-northwest of Port Blair in the Bay of Bengal, just west of Andaman Nicobar Islands. This earthquake caused widespread damage on Middle and South Andaman Islands. Most masonry structures in and around Port Blair were badly affected. The cellular jail, which was a three-story structure with 696 solitary cells, infamous for the imprisonment, torture, and murder of freedom fighters, was also destroyed. The maximum intensity was experienced at Barathang Island, Shoal Bay Creek, north of Port Blair and near Port Anson. Tremors from the earthquake were felt in cities along the east coast of India and even in Colombo, Sri Lanka. In Madras, now called Chennai, two tremors were felt, the first lasting for 2 seconds and the second lasting 15 seconds. It was felt throughout the city, mostly by people in tall buildings. At some locations, doors and windows are reported to have slammed with a bang and chairs rocked. Articles kept on shelves also fell onto the floor. The tremors in the city were reported to have been the strongest since 1899. At Vishakhapatnam, two shocks were experienced within 2 minutes. People went outdoors on feeling the tremors, as did employees at the municipal buildings in the city. They felt the buildings rocking, so understandably they panicked and ran out. People outdoors are said to have had an unusual experience. Tremors were also experienced at Calcutta, Chandranagore and Cuttack. Shaking was felt for duration of 4 minutes at Cuttack. Tremors were felt in Colombo, Sri Lanka for a few seconds and also at Sylhet in Bangladesh, where the car festival was suspended due to the quake. There are no reports of tremors being felt from Sumatera in Indonesia. The earthquake was followed by several powerful aftershocks. Two events with magnitude 6 struck within 24 hours of the main shock on the 27th of June 1941. The first occurred at 7:32 AM GMT and the other at 8:32 AM GMT. These were then followed by 14 earthquakes of magnitude 6 till January 1942. That was a good 6 months after the main quake. A tsunami was triggered by this earthquake in the Bay of Bengal. As per journalistic sources, the height of the tsunami was of the order of 0.75 to 1.25 meters. At that time, no tide gauge was in operation, hence no instrumental records are available. Mathematical calculations suggest that the height could be of the order of 1 meter. The tsunami was witnessed along the eastern coast of India. Dr. George Pararis Karayannis, the retired director of the International Tsunami Society, has a very elaborate web page dedicated to history of tsunamis. The link of this has been put up in the description box below in our YouTube channel. Please do watch the video. The Balochistan earthquake of M8.1 triggered a ferocious tsunami in the Arabian Sea on the 27th of November 1945. A magnitude 8.1 earthquake occurred on the 27th of November 1945 at 2156 minutes GMT in the Northern Arabian Sea off the Makran coast. The earthquake's intensity was high throughout the region. It was felt strongly in Balochistan and Las Bella area of what is today Pakistan, which is west of the Indus Delta. In 1945, of course, Pakistan had not come into being. This area was part of undivided India. The earthquake was also felt in Karachi, where ground motions lasted approximately 30 seconds, stopping the clock in the Karachi municipality building and interrupting the communication cable link between Karachi and Muscat in Oman. Ground motions were felt as far away as Calcutta on the eastern seaboard of the Indian subcontinent. The epicenter was estimated to be at 24 degrees 2 north and 62 degrees 6 east, about 408 kilometers south-southwest of Karachi and 465 kilometers north-northeast of Muscat in Oman. The epicenter was in the Northern Arabian Sea, just off the continental shelf, not at a great depth, hence the power of the tsunami would have been tumultuous. The quake caused extensive damage throughout the region. Subsequent eruptions of mud volcanoes in Balochistan region of Pakistan formed 4 small islands. The damage from the earthquake was great, but the greatest destruction to the region was caused by the tsunami that was generated. Tsunami waves swept the whole of the Arabian Sea coast. It is estimated that 4,000 people were killed. The fishing village of Khudi in Pakistan and its entire population, 48 kilometers west of Karachi, was swept away. The trading towns of Pasni and Ormara in Pakistan, located 100 kilometers away from the epicenter, were flooded by about a 15 meter high wall of water. At least 3 waves at 5:30 a.m., 7 a.m. and 8:15 a.m. Indian Standard Time, over 2 meters high, reached Karachi, 408 kilometers away, as well as Bombay, which was 1,200 kilometers away. In Karachi, the waves persisted for so long that significant harbor damage and loss of life occurred. It is reported that tsunami waves as high as 11 to 11.5 meters struck the Kutch region of Gujarat on the west coast of India. Note that in the Kutch region, the tidal range is usually as high as 6 meters. Hence, the tsunami which occurred during the high tide might have caused high waves. There was extensive destruction and loss of life. Eyewitnesses reported that the tsunami came in like a fast rising tide. In Bombay Harbour, Versova, Haji Ali, Juhu and Khar, the height of the tsunami was 2 meters. 15 persons were washed away. According to reports, the first wave was observed at 8:15 a.m. Local time on Salsette Island in Mumbai. There was no report on damage at the Bombay Harbour. 5 people died at Versova, Andheri in Mumbai and 6 more at Haji Ali in Mahalakshmi, Mumbai. Several fishing boats were torn off their moorings at Danda and Juhu. Hainse in 1948 reported that the first wave reached Pasni on the Makran post about half an hour after the earthquake, but greater damage was caused by a wave that came 3 hours 25 minutes after the first wave. Ambersays and Melville in 1982 have also stated that the first wave did not cause much damage. They reported that the two destructive waves arrived 90 to 120 minutes after the first at Pasni and Ormara. Further, they reported that the high waves persisted for a long duration at Karachi. Hainse in 1948 concurred and noted the times of series of high waves that struck there for a period of around 3 hours after the arrival of the initial wave. The first sea level observation in Seychelles was at 5:47 a.m. GMT, which was 7 hours 40 minutes after the earthquake, when the sea level observed was 30 centimeters, while the normal level of tide at that time was 4 centimeters. The sea level rose to 46 centimeters at 5:52 a.m. GMT, dropped down to 0, and then rose again to 37 centimeters at 6:13 a.m. GMT. The travel time of tsunami to Seychelles was around 6 hours as computed from our numerical model. In essence, the observations of Beer and Stagg in 1946 suggest that sea level oscillations persisted for more than 2 hours at Seychelles. According to available reports, high waves persisted along the Makran coast and at Karachi for several hours after the arrival of the first wave. On the other hand, only one high wave was reported from Mumbai. Tide gauge records of the tsunami from Karachi and Mumbai confirm these reports. While the data from Mumbai shows a single high wave, Karachi data shows that high waves persisted for more than 7 hours, with the maximum wave height occurring 2 hours 40 minutes after the arrival of the first wave. Neetu et al. In 2011 analyzed the cause of these persistent high waves using a numerical model and revealed that the persistent high waves along the Makran coast and at Karachi were due to the trapping of the tsunami wave energy on the continental shelf of the Makran coast. These coastal trapped edge waves were trapped in a longshore direction, that means parallel to the coast, within around 300 km stretch of the continental shelf. This much data has not been made available in the mass media. Generations of journalists who have learned reporting skills on the job have not displayed nor practiced investigative curiosity about reporting anything apolitical in scope. It makes an interesting study as to why not one Indian print media article could be fished out in 6 decades of independent Indian press about the tsunamis around the Indian Ocean coast. Let me do the number crunching for you. The total number of registered newspapers or periodicals was 65,032 as on 31st of March 2007. Among them, there are 7,131 dailies, 374 tri or bi-weeklies, 22,116 weeklies, 8,547 fortnightlies, 19,456 monthlies, 4,470 quarterlies and 605 annual publications and 2,333 of the other category or periodicity. I sourced statistics up to 31st of March 2007 from the Registrar of Newspapers in India. I could not gather much of such reporting from Southeast Asian newspapers either. Alas, if there had been this kind of investigative curiosity, I have no doubts at all that more than a few thousand lives would have been saved during the Asian tsunami. When the Asian tsunami struck in 2004, I had by then been in journalism for 13 long years and I too share this blame shamefully. The obsession for political news disallows scope for earth sciences and reporting across the media scape. However, let me draw an interesting parallel in digital media. Many of us are subscribers to a news group discussion on Andaman Nicobar Islands. This discussion group is largely comprised of writers, broadcasters, intellectuals, activists, and some scholars. Some years ago, a native islander started chronicling the jail escape of a convict from Cellular Jail, the infamous Alapani Penitentiary of the Andamans. The writer fictionalized parts of the convict's escape and laced it with imaginary conflict situations with crocodiles, intrigue in the geology of the islands, and so on. All of us used to wait eagerly for the narrative once a week. The need for apolitical discourse in a responsible media is felt when we consider the grave dangers geology puts us through. One British student who knew the potential of a tsunami saved the lives of many holidayers in Thailand the day the Asian tsunami struck. The Indian mediascape deprives us the space for such investigative journalism, especially in the earth sciences, since it is not hot political news. In October 1991, let me narrate an incident from my own professional experience. In October 1991, the Barren Island volcano had erupted. If you recall, Barren Island is in the Bay of Bengal. It's part of the Andaman Nicobar Islands. My chief editor, Mr. G.K.C. Reddy at Bangalore Eveninger, where I had been working as a cub reporter immediately after my graduation from the Bangalore University, had asked me to write an editorial on the eruption because you like to write about the environment, he said. My imagination ran riot, and I even linked it to the landslide in Chamoli in Uttarakhand in Himalayas. It's called as a Malpa landslide, which occurred on, I think 19th October 1991. It had taken a huge human toll. I grasped for breath and said, "Sir, the volcanic eruption could possibly be linked geologically to the Chamoli landslide, and if the lava from the Barren Island volcano touches the sea, it can potentially trigger a tsunami in the Bay of Bengal," I told, rather excited. "What is a tsunami?" he asked. I explained that it is a seismic wave. I spelled it out too. I distinctly remember him laughing it off, saying, "Malini, what are you saying? A landslide in Himalayas cannot trigger a volcanic eruption in the Bay of Bengal and cause this seismic wave," he said. I called out saying, "It did when the Krakatau volcano erupted in 1883 in Indonesia." Mr. Reddy laughingly had walked out from the corridor where our conversation had transpired. Indeed, there might not have been a tsunami in the Bay of Bengal following the 1991 eruption of Barren Island volcano at all. Dr. Satish Shenoy, the former director of Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services, told me this when I asked him. I quote from the book where he has given me an interview. "We do not have records to ascertain whether a local tsunami occurred following the eruption of the volcano on Barren Island. Also, I have no reasons to believe that it had caused a tsunami. To generate a tsunami, the eruption should dump a large quantity of lava into the sea, suddenly causing a disturbance to the water column. Slow outflow of lava is not going to disturb the water column abruptly, causing a tsunami." That possibly explains why Iceland's frequent volcanic eruptions followed by lava outflow to the sea do not create tsunamis in the Atlantic Ocean. I must admit, I did not know Dr. Satish Shenoy back in 1991 when I was a cub reporter. Nor was INCOIS established for that matter. None in the Indian polity, apart from oceanographers and a few hundred well-read people, knew about tsunamis in 1991 in India. Tsunamis are rare in the Indian Ocean rim states. Tsunamis have been relatively rare in the Indian Ocean, at least in human memory, says Dr. T. Srinivas Kumar, in charge oceanographer of the Indian Tsunami Warning Center at the Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services in Hyderabad. The most notable tsunamis in the Indian Ocean region prior to the Asian tsunami of December 2004 have been the 1941 tsunami in the Bay of Bengal that we have already studied, the 1945 tsunami in the Arabian Sea, the Krakatau supervolcanic eruption between Sumatra and Java that caused tsunamis in August 1883, and Sanriku, Japan on the 15th of June 1896. Other memorable tsunamis in human history are the North Pacific Coast, Japan, 11th March 2011, Lisbon, Portugal on the 1st of November 1755, Enshunada Sea, Japan, 20th September 1498, Nankaido, Japan, 28th October 1707, Northern Chile, 13th August 1868, Ryukyu Islands, Japan, 24th April 1771, Ise Bay, Japan, 18th January 1586, according to the Australian Geographic. The link is available in the description box below this video. In recent memory, for example, the Haiti earthquake of 12th January 2010 did not trigger a tsunami in the Atlantic Ocean despite it being a magnitude 7 earthquake. This was because the epicenter was on subterranean dry land in the southwestern peninsula, with the epicenter at 18.443 degrees north and 72.571 degrees west. I asked Dr. Tad Murthy, when was the last tsunami in the Atlantic Ocean? He says the 1755 Lisbon earthquake triggered tsunami and the November 18, 1929 Grand Bank tsunami were the last recorded one. The Pacific Ocean's Ring of Fire is more prone to cause tsunamis. Why then is the South Atlantic Ocean completely devoid of tsunami? To my knowledge, Dr. Tadmurthy says, there has been no recorded major tsunami in the South Atlantic Ocean. However, in nature, one can never say never. The absence of tsunamis here is more to do with the lack of appropriate tectonic plates than the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, Dr. Tadmurthy explained. Now we come to the Japanese Sendai Tohoku earthquake and tsunami of 2011. The term tsunami is Japanese in origin and implies displacement of water that can be caused by a variety of causes. The Japanese tsunami of March 2011, too, was pulverizing because the Japanese, albeit being used to and prepared for smaller earthquakes every day, were ill prepared for the big one. This earthquake was of magnitude 9 and places the earthquake as the fourth largest in the world since 1900 and the largest in Japan since modern instrumental recordings began 130 years ago. According to a press release of the United States Geological Survey, the link of which is placed in the description box below. There are 3 to 4 earthquakes daily that hit the Japanese islands, but these minor quakes only cause mild tremors. So the Japanese are very used to these minor quakes. They know what to do, where to duck, how to protect themselves from shaking objects or falling debris. But the Sendai Tohoku mega earthquake was a subduction earthquake in shallow coast. The epicenter was only 30 kilometers deep on the continental shelf. The Japanese tsunami that ensued was a result of the ocean floor heaving up in a colossal dimension at 38.297 degrees north and 142.372 degrees east. The subducting Pacific plate pushed beneath the Eurasian plate on which Japan sits. The ensuing tsunami was a wall of seawater hundreds of kilometers wide, about 40 meters high, and ran up inland up to a distance of almost 10 kilometers in some places. 20,352 people died, according to the United States Geological Survey. The WHO of the United Nations estimates from the Western Pacific Regional Office that 15,848 lives were lost in Great East Japan earthquake or the Tohoku earthquake of March 11, 2011. But a Japanese National Police Agency report confirmed 15,883 deaths, 6,143 injured, and 2,681 people missing from across 20 prefectures, as well as 129,225 buildings that were totally damaged and collapsed, with a further 254,204 buildings which half collapsed and another 691,766 buildings partially damaged. The link of the source is also put up in our description box below. It is relevant to repeat Dr. Tad Murthy's remarks on early warning again. Quote, please note that even if we have a perfect warning system, from a scientific point of view, there will still be some loss of life because it is practically impossible to reach every single person in all the vulnerable areas and evacuate them to safety in time, unquote. More than evacuation in Japan, the cause for deaths was the tsunami waters gushing over tsunami walls and pummeling into cities inland, carrying burning debris and tossing ships into whirlpools, throwing a train off track. It is impossible to evacuate train passengers or berth a ship at sea at short notice. Preparedness for such situations lies in factoring in seismicity or history of tsunamis in the areas where the tracks and ports or infrastructure are located, meaning such infrastructure should not be located in highly seismic or tsunami-genic areas. The megathrust earthquake created a few other secondary disasters, notably the ensuing tsunami and the nuclear meltdown at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant. There were also landslides and landslips, fires caused by friction on debris, building and infrastructure damage, nuclear incidents, including radiation releases and the ship and train disasters, of course. Yet, in comparison to the Asian tsunami, the death toll was lower at 20,352 fatalities, partially because the early warning issued by the authorities in Japan was effective and the Japanese population knew what to do. Also because population densities in rural Japan are possibly lower than around the Indian Ocean littoral states. People received the early warning signals correctly and ran to higher ground for safety. Passengers on the ships and the trains and those people who could not run to safety perished. The world watched in horror the developments in Japan on television as a ship was caught in swirling whirlpools in oscillating waves. As helicopters hovered over a train that was dismembered, news broke out of the tsunami waters inundating the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear reactor. It was mind-numbing for television viewers. One can only imagine the horror of the Japanese. It was the third disaster in so many days that hit Japan. It shook Japan society and economy really hard, even denting their confidence, discipline and culture in the months after the disaster. The Asian tsunami with a magnitude of 9.3 recorded a maximum height of around 33 meters, while the Tohoku earthquake with a magnitude of 9 recorded a maximum run-up of around 40.5 meters, says Dr. T. Srinivas Kumar, who explained the similarities for me. In some places, he said, the tsunami ran up to 10 kilometers inland. To respect the ultimate sacrifice the passengers on that ship and on that train in Japan made, we must solemnly learn the lessons from the disaster and prevent future disasters resulting from inevitable natural calamities. Quote, most tsunamis are caused by earthquakes of the magnitude of more than 6.5, with a vertical disruption of the water column generally caused by a vertical tectonic displacement of the seabed along a zone of fracture in the earth's crust. It underlies or borders the ocean floor. Tsunamis are also generated by volcanic eruptions and submarine landslides. The speed of tsunami waves depends on the depth of the water, typically varying from 500 to 1000 kilometers per hour in the deep ocean and a few tens of kilometers per hour near shore. The time period of the tsunami wave ranges from a few minutes to an hour or even more. Unquote. Dr. Srinivas Kumar completes the explanation for our understanding. As the tsunami nears the coast, the shallow coasts heave up the tsunami higher and add to the pressure of tons of water per square centimeter of seawater, as this film by Alexander Kahlenberg depicts. The YouTube link of this particular film by Alexander Kahlenberg has been put up in the YouTube in our description box. Don't miss it. Thereafter, the contours of the coast that the tsunami is approaching make the difference between life and death for the coastal populations. If the coasts are bald and devoid of vegetation, chances of the invading tsunami marauding civilization are far higher than when compared to biodiverse coasts dotted with bioshields like mangrove and littoral forests, or even the presence of reefs in the sea can stymie the marauding wave's power. Aquaculture ponds also accounted for decimation of mangroves and littoral forests near coastal Tamil Nadu. In an article that I did for the Interpress News Service, the link of which is there in the description box, former field director of India's Gulf of Mannar Marine National Park, Mr. Shekhar Kumar Neeraj in Rameshwaram, told me, quote, coral reefs and mangrove ecosystems help in mitigating hydrometeorological disasters because coral reefs absorb dynamic forces of the wind of tsunamis and cyclones like we experienced during the Asian tsunami in December 2004. They channelize currents and reduce the velocity of the wave actions like a barrier. The reefs are the long walls of corals and act in the same manner while covering a long length. Once the intensity of the wind is reduced, the cyclonic wind loses its strength and the impact is much less. The islands, which have coral origin and constitution in the Gulf of Mannar, demonstrated least impact. The reefs also change the course of tides, regulate sea surface temperatures, and thus prevent or regulate cyclone occurrences. The Gulf of Mannar Marine National Park, characterized by an underwater reef, effectively prevented damage from the tsunami, while the absence of such reefs north of Rameswaram saw a widespread damage to the coastal entities. Nagapattinam was devastated by the tsunami, unquote. For the same article, Dr. V. Selvam, the director of the Coastal Systems Research at the M. S. Swaminathan Research Foundation in Chennai, told me, quoting MSSRF's toolkit for establishing coastal bioshields. He says, the role of mangroves in mitigating the impact of tsunami was studied in two villages in the Pichavaram region in coastal Tamil Nadu. One village called T.S. Pettai has and still has mangroves between the sea and the village, and another village, Murukutturai, is directly exposed to the sea due to the absence of mangroves. Both villages are located more or less at the same distance from the sea and are also at the same elevation. Both are fishing villages and socio-economic conditions are similar. During 2004 tsunami, there was no human casualty and there was no damage to the properties, including houses in the T.S. Pettai village, which is protected by mangroves. Sea water intruded into only a small portion of land. However, in Murukutturai, or the village which is unprotected from mangroves, 11 people died and 136 houses, or 88%, were totally damaged due to the forceful entry of seawater. We will study the role of mangroves, littoral forests and coral reefs, together called bioshields, in chapter 20 on the role of bioshields in disasters. The nearest coasts are pummeled by the force of water. Waves of up to 10.5 meters in height struck northern Sumatra, the Nicobar group of islands and the Andaman Nicobar Islands, Thailand, Sri Lanka and mainland India during the Asian tsunami. Destructive waves also struck the Maldives, Somalia, Kenya, and the islands off the African coast like Zanzibar. The tsunami was recorded by tide gauge stations not only in the Indian Ocean but in the Pacific as well. In Manzanillo, Mexico, the tide gauge recorded a wave of up to 2.6 meters, says Dr. George Pararas Karayannis, president of the International Tsunami Society and one of the world's leading tsunami scientists and marine geologists. Now we come to the Krakatau supervolcanic eruption, which caused cataclysmic tsunamis in 1883. It is one of the most explosive of volcanic eruptions in modern history. Dr. George Pararas Karayannis on the tsunamis generated by the Krakatau volcano. He has given me written permission to reproduce large amounts of his research studies. Here is one such item. Quote, the paroxysmal explosion and collapse of the volcano of Krakatau generated formidable tsunami waves that were up to 37 meters or 120 feet in height. These waves destroyed 295 towns and villages in the Sunda Strait in western Java and southern Sumatra. A total of 36,417 people drowned. The tsunami, being of volcanic origin, was only destructive locally in Indonesia. However, small tsunami waves were recorded throughout the Pacific. Undoubtedly, the atmospheric pressure waves from the three gigantic eruptions of Krakatau on 26th and 27th of August 1883, which preceded the fourth paroxysmal explosion, gave rise to tsunami-like waves. I must bring to your attention here that there are a lot of pictures of the Krakatau supervolcano that's running in the background slideshow here. The first of these three preceding violent explosions occurred at 17:07 Greenwich Mean Time on the 26th of August 1883. The second and the third violent eruptions occurred at 5:30 a.m. GMT and at 6:44 a.m. GMT on 27th of August 1883. Being of atmospheric origin and small in size, none of these earlier tsunami-like waves were noticed or reported. At the time, the only operating tide gauge in Batavia or Jakarta was too far away to record these smaller sea level oscillations. It was the fourth paroxysmal explosion of Krakatau at 10:02 a.m. GMT that gave rise to gigantic destructive tsunami waves in the Sunda Strait. This paroxysmal explosion blew away the northern two-thirds of the island, and it was almost instantaneously followed by the collapse of the unsupported volcanic chambers which formed the huge underwater caldera. It was the combined effects of the explosion and collapse of the volcano that generated the catastrophic tsunami waves that caused havoc and destruction in the Sunda Strait. The huge tsunami waves destroyed all the coastal towns and villages on the Sunda Strait within an hour or two after the explosion and collapse of the volcano. The waves were so powerful that coral blocks weighing as much as 600 tons were thrown ashore. A warship in the sea was carried 3 kilometers inland by the waves and was deposited at a 10-meter high elevation above sea level. The huge tsunami was well documented in terms of visual observations of heights reached along the coast of Java and Sumatra, as well as from a recording at a tide gauge at Batavia, which is now called Jakarta. The tsunami travel time to the closest villages of Sumatra was about 1 hour after the explosion at Krakatau. At Telok Betong, tsunami waves of up to 22 meters or 72 feet in height completely submerged the village. At Flaka Hook, the maximum tsunami wave height was 15 meters. Also, tsunami waves reached the western coast of Java within an hour after the explosion of Krakatau. The village of Sirik was almost entirely swept away by these waves. It took also about an hour for the destructive tsunami waves to reach Anyer, where a 10-meter high wave completely overwhelmed the lower part of town. At Thuringen, waves ranged from 15 to 20 meters in height, while at Merak, the waves reached a maximum of 35 meters. It took approximately 2.5 hours for the tsunami waves to refract around the western end of the island of Java and to reach Batavia or Jakarta, the capital of Indonesia. By the time the tsunami reached Surabaya at the eastern part of Java, the reported wave was only 0.2 meters. The tsunami travel time to Surabaya was 11.9 hours. Small sea level oscillations from Krakatau's explosion were recorded by the tide gauges as far away as Hawaii on the American west coast, as well as South America, and even as far away as the English Channel in France and England. It took 12 hours for the tsunami from Krakatau's explosion to reach Aden on the southern tip of the Arabian Peninsula, some 3,800 nautical miles away. The wave reported at Aden probably represents the one generated in the Sunda Strait. The travel time of a little over 300 nautical miles per hour to Aden appears reasonable. There were no land boundaries on the Indian Ocean side of Krakatau to prevent the tsunami energy from spreading in that direction. However, it is doubtful that the waves which were reported at distant locations in the Pacific or in the Atlantic Ocean represented the actual tsunami generated in the Sunda Strait. Very little, if at all, any of this energy could have escaped the surrounding inland seas to the east of the Sunda Strait. Most probably, the small waves that were observed in the Pacific as well as in the Atlantic were generated by the atmospheric pressure waves which resulted from the major Krakatau explosion and not from the actual tsunami generated in the Sunda Strait. On YouTube, there are several good videos that graphically show what happened on that fateful day, according to Dr. George Pararas Karayannis. He says the epicenter of the December 26, 2004 earthquake was near the triple junction point of these three tectonic plates where major earthquakes and tsunamis have occurred in the past. Previous major earthquakes have occurred further north in the Andaman Sea and further south along the Sumatra and the Sunda sections of one of the Earth's greatest fault zones, a subduction zone known as the Sunda Trench. This great trench extends for about 3,400 miles or about 5,440 kilometers from Myanmar, that is Burma, south past Sumatra and Java and east towards Australia and the Lesser Sunda Islands, ending up near Timor. Slippage and plate subduction make this region highly seismic. The volcanoes of Krakatau, Tambora and Toba, well known for their violent eruptions, are byproducts of such tectonic interactions, unquote. The Krakatau volcanic eruption was so violent, it changed the science and understanding of many fields of earth sciences, including volcanology, seismic studies, and marine geology. In the article Cataclysms from Below, in the book The World Around Us, author Noel F. Bush writes, quote, "A small island between Java and Sumatra, Krakatau, has long been recognized as a stump of an old volcano. Its three craters, however, had been inactive for over 200 years and were assumed to be extinct. When explosive sounds were heard from one of Krakatau's craters on the 20th of May 1883, the noises aroused more curiosity than alarm. In the next few days, an excursion steamer visited the island, bringing a party of sightseers whose more mettlesome members climbed the peak and there observed a column of steam roaring out of a vent 30 yards wide, or about 27.4 meters wide. Early in August, several explosions occurred that were heard all over Western Java. Apparently, the volcano walls collapsed and seawater poured into the openings, creating steam. Then at 10.02 a.m. on the 27th of August 1883, the steam caused the whole mountain to erupt. It proved to be the most violent explosion recorded in modern times. 4 hours afterward, the detonation was heard 2,968 miles or 4,342 kilometers away. The tidal waves caused by the blast reached a height of 120 feet or 36.5 meters, flooding and destroying some 300 towns and killing 36,000 people. Ashes, including great quantities of powdered pumice stone, darkened the skies for 275 miles or 440 kilometers around. 3 days after the explosion, ashes rained down on the decks of ships 1,600 miles away or 2,560 kilometers away. Fine dust remained in the Earth's upper atmosphere for over a year afterward, causing brilliant red sunsets and sky glows as far away as the east coast of the United States. Mind you, there is the Pacific Ocean and the west coast of the United States before we come to the east coast of the United States. Fire engines were called out in some cities in America to extinguish what looked like conflagrations in nearby areas. The disastrous eruption of Krakatoa, followed within 2 decades by that of Mount Pele, gave volcanology its major impetus, unquote. Krakatoa expunged up to 20 million tons of sulfur into the atmosphere, causing crimson sunsets in America and cooling the planet by shielding the sun, from the sun for a good 50 years before a fresh eruption caused by magma formation in 1927. Let us not let tsunamis terrorize humanity. It is part of a geological process. In the process, cataclysmic changes occur. If we are prepared for these cataclysmic phenomena, maybe we can accept these processes as part of life and go on with our lives. Indonesians are hardly alarmed by volcanoes. Icelanders reckon with their heaving geology as part of their culture. Shall we try as well? Let us try to be prepared for the next time the ocean unleashes her secrets to make this world a safer place for us to live in. Volcanoes are not just fire-breathing, heaving mountains. They play a critical role in geology. Supervolcanic eruptions have triggered ice ages by causing volcanic winters. There have been famines, floods, pestilences and pandemics caused by volcanic winters. The Krakatoa eruption of 22nd of December 2018, which triggered a tsunami killing more than 450 people in Indonesia, brought home to us our lack of preparedness for volcanic eruptions. Volcanic triggers of tsunamis and the role of seamounts or submarine volcanoes are also under study. In fact, in the slideshow, I have shown pictures of a band which was playing somewhere very close to the coast of the Sunda Straits, and many people who were watching the live performance were killed by this unexpected tsunami, which was triggered by the unexpected volcanic explosion of Anak Krakatoa on the 22nd of December 2018. More than 450 people died, unfortunately. The tsunami generated by the sudden eruption of Krakatoa on the 22nd of December 2018 reflects the lack of preparedness for volcano-induced tsunamis. In fact, seamounts or submarine volcanoes are hardly studied in depth outside of the United States Geological Survey. Volcanic eruptions are preceded by earthquake swarms, and these are intensely monitored by multiple seismic stations globally on broadband data these days. Scientists are also able to measure the lava buildup in the magma chamber. By calibrating these two factors against historical database of volcanic explosions and cross-checking against the lunar cycle, it should be possible to arrive at a reasonably accurate forecast of dates for volcanic explosions. It is not just enough to be prepared for pyroclastic flows and lava flows or lahars. Bathymetric profiles near seamounts and volcanic fields can yield data to forecast paths of volcano-triggered tsunamis that will save thousands of lives and livelihoods. Consider that there are around 1,500 active volcanoes and seamounts around the Pacific Ring of Fire. Robust scientific database management is called for. Thereafter, it is the job of governments to prepare the population for volcanic disasters inclusively in proportion to per capita human development index. Volcanic explosions have long-term impacts on near and mid-term climate changes at micro and macro levels. There was a study published by the University of Leeds in 2014 which substantiated that the colossal ash plumes from one Icelandic volcano had neutralized entire carbon emissions from industrial pollution in all of Europe on a one day of measurement. Among the long-term impacts, what remains to be studied are changes in iron content and the links to propensity for pandemics. Only after these scientific data are established can preparedness begin. Dr. Karayannis mentions that it was the iron content and the pressure in the atmosphere which triggered certain tsunamis during the aftermath of the 1883 Krakatoa volcanic eruption and the consequent tsunami. So the role played by iron content or the changes in the iron content in the atmosphere need to be very crucially studied to make a more in-depth analysis of volcano-triggered tsunamis. Well, dear viewers, let us at least be informed. It is the first step in being prepared. Scholars have made efforts to put such fantastic research together. Let us study them at least. The scale of devastation is directly proportional to the density of human population in the coastal areas. Other factors like awareness, demographic profile, children, women, and physically challenged people might be more vulnerable too. So, inclusive preparedness and a higher human development index are quintessential to mitigate the impact of natural calamities on human landscape. That is all for today. Thank you so much for tuning in. In the next week's book reading session, we will meet survivors of the Asian tsunami and get acquainted with some of their once-in-a-lifetime experience. Do mark your calendars and tune in to our channel at 7 p.m. Indian time. After the book reading, there will be an interactive Q&A session for about 30 minutes. Hope to see you there. Take care, safe, and keep smiling. I'm Malini Shankar signing off from Digital Discourse Foundation tonight. I will be available for Q&A right after this.